Hello, this is Chaplain Stevens with the New Jersey Institute of Theological Studies. And today we're going to be talking about a subject that's sometimes controversial, and not too many Bible scholars totally agree on this topic, and that's the topic of free will. You know, quite often I hear Christians say, well, God gave man free will, and that's accurate to an extent. Once you become a believer and you give your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ, that terminology no longer really exists. We don't really have free will when you give your heart to the Lord, because you were bought with a price. And the best example I can give of that is Noah. God told Noah to go to Nineveh and preach to the Ninevites. Well, the Ninevites were very evil. They were horrible people. They sacrificed people on brazen altars, and they were just hideous, horrible, cruel people. So when God told Jonah to go to Nineveh, he said, no, I'm not doing it. And he got on a boat, and he decided, I'm going to go to Tarshish. Tarshish would be where Spain is right now. So he got on a boat and said, I'm going to Tarshish, as far away from God's will as I can get. And one of the things I need to express to my fellow believers is, once you give your heart to the Lord and you become His property, and you have a call on your life, you know, your free will can't override the perfect will of God. And the perfect will of God was for Jonah to go preach to the Ninevites. And Jonah decided he didn't want to. So what did God do? God arranged a fish to take him back to Nineveh, a one-way express trip back to Nineveh. And some of you here today, you're about to get a fish to visit your house. Now, of course, it's not going to be the same fish or same type of creature that took Jonah, but God has a way to get us to do His will. And I'll use myself as an example. I'm going to share a testimony with you how God got me when I decided I didn't really want to be a preacher. I was in the military, and I was already a deacon, but I had really no designs on ever stepping up in a pulpit or being a preacher. I was just happy being a deacon, you know, counting money, visiting the sick. I liked that, but didn't want to preach. And I'll never forget, I got an assignment to Honduras. I had to do a 90-day tour to Honduras. And after my 90 days, I was supposed to come back to the States. Well, what ended up happening was the young lady that was supposed to replace me in Honduras, something happened. She had a tragedy or something in her family, and I ended up having to do another 45 days in Honduras. And while I was there, I was at this location that was right outside the jungle. It wasn't a great place to be. It was hot. It was miserable. We were sleeping in tents. There were tarantulas all over the place. But one of the reasons why God allowed me to go there was because I had nothing but time on my hands. I had no television, no telephone. It was just me, my Bible, and God. And while I was there, I ran into two young men that were both Catholics. And one day they saw me read my Bible, and they said, are you a minister? And I said, no, I'm a deacon. And they said, well, in the Catholic Church, a deacon is like a minister. And in reality, a deacon is a minister. But I was just trying to avoid being called a minister or a preacher. And so these guys would come, you know, and hang around my tent every day. And it got to the place where they literally invited themselves into my tent for Bible study. And they said, well, can we have a church service? And they said, you know, can't you? We used to go into Mass every day. So these guys bugged me until I went to the commander and got permission to use a tent, to turn that tent into our chapel. To make a long story short, you know, after my 100 plus days in Honduras, I was preaching in that tent. I was praying for sick people. I was, you know, leading folks to Christ. And I'll never forget, when I got ready to come back to the States, it was like the Lord just quietly said to me, you can't run from my will. I called you for this. And when I got back to the States, I went to my pastor and told him what happened. And he went in his office and came back out with a minister's certificate and said, here you go. I've been waiting for you to tell me this. So You can't run from God's will. Let me share a couple of verses with you before we leave, just to help you understand. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19, it says, "You are not your own. You were bought with a price." The shed blood of Jesus Christ was the price that was paid to purchase us. And not just to be saved, but so we could do his perfect will. And a lot of people, they say they're running from callings. You can't run from a calling. If God's got a call in your life, you're going to do it. And I can give you countless examples of this in my own life, how even when I was out in the world and trying to, do my own thing, there were situations in my life where I was out drinking and partying with people, and they would come to me and ask me questions about the Bible. And I'm like, "Why are you asking me this?" And they say, "Well, we just figured you know." And it's funny because even though I wasn't living anything at that time, I was reading my Bible every day. So I had the answers that they were looking for. So you can't, there's no such thing as free will for the believer. Now, when you're out there running the street and not doing anything for God or thinking about God, yeah, you got free will. Your free will take you to hell also. But once you give your heart to Christ, you are no longer your own. Let's look at another verse. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14. It says, "In him, when you believed, you were marked with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory." See, you were marked when you accepted Christ. And that's why even when we call ourselves backsliding and moving away from God, you can't hide from God. I can remember being in nightclubs and bars and people coming to me saying, "Are you a preacher? What are you doing here?" Didn't even know me, but that mark was on me. And you can't run from your calling. If God's called you to do something, stop running. Don't wait till a fish has to come get you. I mean, I don't think a fish is going to come get you, but it could be something else. You could have a car accident. You can go through a windshield. You can get shot. I've heard many testimonies. I work in a trauma hospital where guys got shot. It took getting shot for them to realize that God had something better for them to do. Don't go through all of that. Just say, "Lord, I surrender." And just give it up and let God use you. Let's look at another verse. Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. It says, "In him when you believed." Oh, we read that one. Let's look at Revelations 12, 11. "Our brothers won the victory over Satan by the blood of the Lamb and by the truth which they proclaimed, and they were willing to give up their lives and die." Men and women died for the cause of Christ. Peter, Paul, James, John, all these guys died so that we might have a right to eternal life. So how dare we not, accept a call that God has on our life? Yeah, that call may cause us to lose our lives. So what? So be it. I'd rather die for Jesus than die for nothing. So let's think about this. When people tell you, "Oh, I got free will." No, you don't. Stop running from your calling. Do what God called you to do. And watch watch your life change. I mean, I'm not going to stand up here like these prosperity preachers and tell you your life's going to get better when you accept your calling. Physically, it might not. God might call you to go to Haiti. He might call you to go to India. He might call you to some bad inner city to minister to gangbangers. So, just because you accept your calling, it might not be to be the next T.D. Jakes. God might call you to be the next Watchman Nee. You might be writing books from a prison cell. So, don't get it twisted. God's will isn't always glamorous. Sometimes God's will is treacherous and hard. But I'd rather do God's will in hardness than to disobey him in ease. God bless you guys. Have a blessed day.